crisis will make you move. Amen? So in the fact that crisis made it necessary that we move, and I won't even get into all the details, but it was a medical crisis on several levels within our family, and the Spirit of the Lord was like, through my wife, and sometimes the Spirit of the Lord sounds just like my wife. Y'all didn't hear that. Sometimes when the Spirit of the Lord talks to me, he sounds just like Sheree A. Brooks, Jr. Somebody said, well, how does she have a junior on her name? She'll tell you in a heartbeat, and she'll tell you tomorrow during our session. I took his whole name. What's mine is yours, what's yours is mine. See, I got too many saved people in the house. It's okay. So she took all that. You get what I'm saying? She's a Marine, and she takes all that. So the truth of the matter is that, guys, listen to me. We literally recognize that collectively, we've been married for well over 30 years between the two of us, and we have screwed it up so royally that we could probably teach you how to get it right by what not to do. As a matter of fact, there's two books, the most recent ones that we've written. One is called Marriage Works When You Do the Work, Five Things You Need to Know. And we struggled because we were going to call this Marriage Works When You Do the Work, 101 Things Not to Do. And the reason why is because we've made all the mistakes. Now, I want y'all to track me really quickly. I do not have to drink and drive in order to know that that doesn't mix. The problem with human beings, the problem with our culture, is that we don't believe that to be true. We have to have our own experience. How many times have your kids told you, yeah, that's good for you, Mom, that's good for y'all, but I need to know for myself? Well, there's some things I don't need to know for myself. And I'm going to promise you on the front end, divorce is one of those. You don't need to know that for yourself. It is one of the most painful things I've ever had to endure, and I don't ever want to ever have to go through that again if I can help it. Now, there are things that you cannot help. Say things that I can't control. So tonight, we're going to major on what you can control. There's a lot that's without your control, that's just completely out of your control. And as a matter of fact, if you spend a lot of energy trying to control it, you will wear yourself out so that the things that you can control, you have no more energy to control it. And so that too is out of control. Amen? So what I want y'all to know is that when you get this book, we've boiled all of our mistakes down to five. Five things that if you do these five things, you can absolutely make your marriage last forever so that you two can have just two rules. What are the two rules, guys? You can't what? And you can't do what? I pray that that becomes one of your rules. Broken to family to blend it, the process of building a solid family. So I told you guys we were both married before. Sheree had a daughter who was 11 years old. Today she is 33. We had a son at the time, or I had a son coming into marriage. He was four, I think it was, when we met, four maybe. And by the time we got married, I think he was turning five or something like that. Today he'll be 25 in October. And so here's the crazy thing. So I know this, some of this is being recorded a little bit, but I pray to God that they don't hear this because it may embarrass them, but I don't care because they ain't paying no bill. At least not mine. So the deal is that my daughter has two master's degrees, and she is at Regent University enrolled in a PhD program to get her PhD at 33 years old. Praise Jesus, right? Now we can really praise the devil. I knew that would mess everybody up. They're like, how are you going to be praised? Because my son, on the other hand, has a GED because he went through high school all his life with an IEP, and I thought I was going to go off because he was ADD on top of all of that. So that's the one, as Dr. Juju said, yeah, that's the one keep me on my knees. Kept me on my knees because I was going to kill him, me, and the whole house. Remember that Richard Pryor joke one time? He said, when he coming out the house, he said, and the police arrested him, said, well, brother, you done killed everybody in the whole house. Why'd you kill everybody? He said, well, they was there. You know what I'm saying? It just seemed like a fine thing to do to me. Because at this point, sometimes people just snap. Say snap. And so when you lose it, guys, there is a challenge with the people that you're connected to. They, too, will lose it. We're going to talk about that a little bit. Say free. Free. Y'all like free stuff? As I talk throughout today's message, what many of you guys are going to say to yourself, I'm going to predict this, is that, man, I sure would like to ask him something very specific to my situation. Because I need a little bit more on what he said, but I'm not going to be able to do that in the context of this event. So if you were to get your phones out really quickly, I'm going to give you my phone number, if that's okay with you. What I'd like you to do is take your phone out really, very quickly. Just take it out, open it up, turn it on. And I'd just like you to take my phone number down and just text me your first and last name. What I'd like to do is I'd like to be able to send you a link that will actually allow you to set up some time with me. Free, won't cost you a dime, 30 minutes of my time, just to talk about what's going on in your world and how can I help. If I can help by referring you somewhere, maybe there's a resource that you need, maybe there's a unique dynamic that's happening to you and you'd like to be able to get, I'm not going to email you nothing. I'm not going to try to, I'm just going to talk. And after that 30 minutes, you may never talk to me, as we may talk, next time we may talk, it might be in heaven. You feel what I'm saying? I just want to be able to avail myself to you, and I'm going to use modern technology to do it. The number is 757-774-6127. 757-774-6127. Anybody need me to repeat it? Okay, for that one that was scared to raise their hand, 757-774-6127. Just text me your first and last name. If you're married and you want to represent the couple, then I only need one text. But if your spouse is not here or you're single and you want to text me, I promise you, I'm going to send you a link that will allow you to set up a 30-minute time frame with me and possibly my wife, depending on what time you schedule it for. And we're going to sit down and kind of walk you through if there's anything we can help you with. Amen? Y'all ready to go? I said, are y'all ready to go? All right. So tonight we're going to talk about some things relative to a subject matter that's very near and dear to my heart, guys. And I want you guys to listen very intently. Here's what I'm going to promise you. Number one, this message will not be eternal. I am a preacher, but I'm a coach. I'm a former radio guy, so I'm very conscious of time. The other part is that I want to go eat after this is over. And the restaurants close kind of early on this side. I don't know if what's happening with y'all Negro population, but folks be scared of them or something. I don't know what's going on, right? Just playing with y'all. Y'all loosen up, because it's. I'm trying to get y'all ready. It's getting ready to get real. Look at your neighbor and say, it's getting ready to get real. Fellas, am I telling the truth? All right, so it ain't going to get fellas real. All right, Aaron? But it's going to get really real. Amen? So now, this particular subject matter, I'm going to lead this right here just because it's a little cumbersome for me, right? And I'm gonna try and figure it out from here. But we're going to talk to you guys a little bit about the idea of covenant versus contract. Now, tonight, the subject matter has to deal with, and I may sit down for a minute just because I'm old and I'm tired. My knees get to hurting sometimes. And I've found that this is how you conserve energy. John Maxwell taught me that, I promise you. I thought to myself, how brilliant. Let's just go down a little bit. There we go. Awesome. So we're going to talk about marriage, communication, intimacy, and financial investment. I'm going to say some things, guys, that's going to be tweetable. When I say tweetable, I'm going to need you to either snapshot it or screenshot me saying it. Raise your hand. You talk back. Say, can you say that again, please, because I'm writing this down. I would suggest that you get your pads out, your pens out, and all that sort of stuff, because some of this stuff will just come out of my mouth, and I won't be able to say it twice. So if you ask me, well, what'd you say? I'm going to say, I don't know. Somebody helped them out. I don't know what I just said. So I want y'all to listen very quickly. I said this earlier. I'm not sure which session it was. But we talked about how marriage, listen to me very carefully, marriage is a partnership. And it's a partnership that's not 50-50. When you talk about marriage is actually a partnership. It's a team. And it's not 50-50. Just because everything is equal, don't make it fair. And just because it's all fair, don't make it equal. And we're going to explain that in a little bit. The other thing I want you to understand is that only in math do two halves make a whole. Only in math. In relationships, that's not true. It's like the adage that 1 + 1 = 2, that's in math. But I promise you, 1/2 + 1/2 does not equal a whole in relationships. It equals 1/2 + another 1/2. When I do this in workshop format, I generally break out a heart that's split. It's like a jigsaw. And what I do is I bring those two halves together. And because it's like a jigsaw, once we marry the two, what happens is that from the naked eye, it looks like it's a whole. Mm-hmm. But if you get up on it really close, You can see the crack. Say the crack in the foundation. Say foundation. Before we go into the subject matter tonight, I want to define for you. I did this for the men earlier, but since, ladies, you weren't in it, I'm going to do you a solid, and I'm going to share this with you. And it's just a working definition that's going to be tweetable, because I kind of made it up and formed it, but I'm going to tell you how I got there of what foundation and what restoring it looks like. Remember, we're talking about two halves. They don't make a whole in marriage. And if you go into marriage, if you go into any kind of relationship like that and you're thinking, I'm going to tell you, you're going to walk away sad. It's a lot like the rich young ruler. You're going to want to be able to do, but you're going to hear a standard that you cannot live up to. You're going to want to be able to make this work, but you're going to hear a standard or a bar that's going to get raised, and you're going to be able to say, you know what? I might as well go on home right now because there's no way I'm going to clear that bar. And that happens in relationships all the time. Say this with me. If I don't learn how to manage my expectations, I will always, 100% of the time, lose. I'm setting this up. We're going somewhere. I'm going to help you. Those of you all who are not married, hold on, because I promise you, the same principle will work for you and your children. The same principle will work for you in a dating relationship. This same principle will work with you and a coworker. This same principle will work with you for anyone that you are in a long-standing relationship that you have to, by default, work with them. I'm going to help you. So I don't want you to check out on me and say, well, I ain't married. This don't apply. I'm not interested in getting married. This don't apply to me. You'll miss it. I came here for you too. Amen? So now, we're talking about, guys, how only in math is 50, does half and a half make a whole. But I want to break down something to you, because I said that when we bring those two halves together, we see a crack in the foundation. Now, I worked for a little bit of a time, right after I got out of the military, in the environmental engineering field. And one of the things that I learned there, and this is sort of, if I have any civil engineers in the building, you'll understand this, or any engineers, many times your weed out courses and some of the stuff will have talked about some of these things. But the truth of the matter is that foundations have to be tested before they're built on. And so in this civil engineering field, you are many times challenged with testing foundations. When I test foundations that's made up of soil, it looks different than the test that I make or I do for concrete. It looks very different than I do for a test of steel. These are all structural things. Say structural. In this building, there are several structural points that make this building stand and continue to stand. And I've just mentioned three core principles of structure. You notice wood is never mentioned when you start talking about structure. And the reason why is because they can burn up. They can immediately be taken down. When they talk about load-bearing walls, many times those walls are made with I-beams or steel behind them as reinforced. When you look at concrete, it has reinforced steel in the concrete, thus making it harder. If you ever go down a bridge and it's being built and you hear off in the distance, it's boom, 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 like this hammer. It is a pneumatic hammer. It's a hammer that's it's huge. It has to have a crane to pick it up. It's huge. But it's driving what they call pylons or piles into the ground because it's got to reach bedrock before they start building. And the reason why is because there's a marriage that needs to be taking place at the bedrock. And if the marriage is not taking place, if it doesn't take up there, then no matter what you build, it will fall. The question is not if, it's when. A lot of marriages are built and your foundations is not found in bedrock. And I'm going to tell you a secret, guys. Jesus is the capstone, not the bedrock. We're talking building, Pop. Jesus is the cornerstone. He's not the bedrock. I'm going to help y'all out in a minute. I'm going to help y'all out. Say, he's going to help me. See, many people think that love is enough to make your relationship work, and I'm going to promise you it's not. See, first of all, you have to define what kind of love are we talking about. And because there's so many facets and so many different kinds of love, if you are trafficking in an Eros kind of a love, or a storage kind of a love, which is a friendly kind of a give and take kind of the love I have for a grandchild kind of love, that is not the kind of love that your marriage can be sustained in. And if somehow this society, this culture has taught you to be able to go after that, to expect that kind of love, you will sorely be disappointed every single time. And because of that, people walk away sad because they're not able to build on, because their love isn't strong enough, because they're not trafficking in the right kind. So now the question is not do you love, it's how do you love? And that takes skill. Learning how to love is a skill set. See, because without Christ, here's what I'm going to promise you. You can't pull that off no way. So now we have to understand, okay, we have the spirit part of it. So because I'm a believer, I'm able to love. But my question is, if that's the only part, then how is it that unbelievers can make their marriages last for 50 years? They don't have Jesus. When they die, not only is their relationship dying, but they're going to go to a Christless eternity. How was it that they were able to make it last for 50 years and you weren't? Because they knew how to love. And I'm going to promise you, it's not just the loving of itself. I know I'm going somewhere tonight. Some of y'all are looking at me like he is messing my theology all the way up. But that's why I came, because part of me as a coach don't care that you got wrong thinking. I'm here to challenge that. See, because here's the challenge I have with believers, as I am one, is that we hide behind the veil of religion. And we put God on things that we can't understand. We dress it up and we say, God told me, so that you don't get to challenge me. I can't challenge you if you say, God spoke to me. What can I say to that, Aaron? God spoke to me and he said. At that particular point, that lets you off the hook with me. The problem is now you're on your own. And now you find yourself floating out there and you don't have community. We're going to talk about that and the importance of that. Most of you all's relationships, listen to me, are coming unglued, not only because you don't know how to love, but you don't have community. You're not in a tribe, and you're doing this by yourself. And I promise you, I've got the history to prove it. It never works. It's a matter of when, not if it falls apart. Let's keep going. Tonight, I want to talk to you guys very quickly and very briefly about this idea of a covenant versus a contract. I don't have all night to unpack this, and I'm not going to even attempt. I pray that you guys come tomorrow, because Sheree and I are going to talk a little bit more about the principles that govern this particular thing, but I'm going to begin to kind of just tip on a few things to help you understand. So a contract, and I'll start there, really is based in falsehood. A contract by nature, and if I have any lawyers in the house, you can understand this to be true. The only reason why we're going through all of these different language things, and you hear terms like, what is the language in the contract? The reason why we need language is because we need to both be on the same page as to how we get out of this. Contracts, the only reason why they are constructed is to give you clauses to get out of it legally. It is to protect people. Y'all ready for this? Covenants provide for people. So tonight I'm going to do my best to lay out several different contrasts between a covenant and a contract. Contracts are meant to give you a way out and legally be able to stand on that ground. How many of y'all know that everything that's legal isn't always just? Slavery was legal. It's legal to keep people out of the country under certain rules. But it ain't just to keep these people's families apart and to treat them like numbers or like they're not human beings. Does that make sense? What I want you guys to understand is that when God created marriage, the idea was is that the marriage would represent his covenant on earth. From the very beginning, Adam and Eve, when he created that, his whole goal was to show you, and if you read scripture enough, it foretold what was to come, in even in the lineage of Christ, in terms of what it took for staying power. And if you read that and you deal with that, you'll understand that covenants were meant to last forever. They were never meant to just undo. That's why at the altar, oftentimes you'll say, till death do we what? And so part of the reason why I predict and I say and I put out there and I rehearse and I tell myself, babe, we only have two rules. We don't get to leave. What I'm doing is I'm honoring my covenant with my words. And so now when I approach a sticky moment in our situation, leaving is not an option. And because leaving is not an option, and we both share this same thing, by the way, if it's an option for one and not the other, we're going to have a problem. Don't get me wrong. Because we're not talking about control here. We're actually talking about a ton of freedom. Just because you're free to be able to execute don't mean that it's legal.
That's good.
Some of us are going through challenges, and some of us are watching our children now pay for things that they didn't sign up for. Because the truth of the matter, it wasn't up to them. Can you imagine the heart of God when Adam and Eve decide to sell the entire human race before they were born down the tube? He had to make a decision. And here's the crazy thing. God is so incredibly brilliant. I mean, we don't even have words to say it. That safety net, fail plan, fail safe plan, plan B, whatever you want to call it, parachute, that was created even before men had the opportunity to mess it up. So he was smart enough to say, you know what? Here's what I know. I'm going to create man, but I'm going to create him with a free will to choose. And I will not be able to override that, because if I do, I break my own law. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a plan that where we're going to go ahead and we're going to show them what it looks like, because we can show them better than we can tell them. Right, Jesus? Right, Dad? I'm serious. It went down just like that. So when God created man, he created family right then and there. That's why he said that I'm making you in my likeness and in my image. That's why it's so difficult to bounce back from. Because literally you're ripping yourself apart from someone that God created you to be connected with forever. Now, I'm sensitive to it. I get it. I've been through it. Don't ever want to go through that again. And so that's why I go so hard in the pain, and I we do what we do. So here's what I want to submit to you guys. God is not concerned about your happiness. He's concerned about your wholeness. And we've heard people say that he wants you to be wholly over happy, but I'm going to tell you something right now, and let's break that wholly all the way down, and we're talking about he wants you to be whole over happy. It is more God's concern that you come in, and we talked about only in Matthew two halves make a whole. God is interested in how do I get her to become a whole so that when she joins him, he's a whole, and they create a whole situation. So therefore, now after that situation gives birth to another situation, it's giving birth to wholeness. And the challenge is that we're not birthing wholeness. Because as broken people, we're coming together with other broken people, and the only thing we can reproduce is brokenness. And if you don't get this concept down, you won't understand these three steps that I'm about to give you, and we're done. I told you, we are not going to be, the message does not have to be eternal in order to be immortal. Old preacher taught me that a long time ago at a funeral. I never will forget. That was the shortest funeral eulogy thing I ever seen in my life. He looked at me, and I was a young youth pastor at the time. He winked his eye at me. Okay. He said, brother, let me just tell you this. Don't you ever forget it. Message ain't got to be eternal in order to be immortal. Let me just explain. You ain't got to be all day with it. So we're almost done. I'm setting you up because tomorrow we're going to bless you. Because I want to sit down and I want to hear your heart. If you come out tomorrow, you're going to get a chance to ask us specific questions. And we may even start that tonight depending on what kind of time we get. I want to hear what are you going through and how can I help. I have a hashtag. It's called hashtag we all need some help. And I started that years ago. And I promise you, if you Google it, 98% of the stuff you find will be linked to what I do. And I didn't mean to do that. But I really live that way. I cannot do anything of significance by myself. Neither can you. Last time I checked, relationships are significant, whether they're marriages or they're parenting. And here's what I know to be true. When you start off on that journey and you try to do that by yourself, not only will you lose, but you will go away naked and bleeding. And so I want you guys to understand that community plays a huge part. Say wholeness. Say, God is not interested in my happiness, but he is interested in my wholeness. Here are three steps to becoming whole, and we're going to be done. Number one is self-awareness. Self-awareness, first step to becoming whole. The reason why Sheree and I can make it is because we're whole, not because we actually love like that. The reason why we're making it is because we're whole, not because we love Jesus all like that. I love Jesus, but I loved Jesus when I was getting a divorce the first time. Can we keep it real? Good, because I was going to do that anyway. So I get saved at 12. I rededicate my life at 18. Baptized in the Holy Spirit and all that good stuff, and in the Pentecostal church, and they done working it out. Jesus, 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 and we all up in here throwing oil and everybody saved. And if they think you ain't saved, they're going to shut you down, and you getting saved today. Up, he crawled out the back door, get him. Sick him, Holy Ghost, sick him. I mean, they say stuff like that. Y'all know what it is. But at 18 years old, I found myself in a pickle. Say pickle. Because I couldn't live the word that I knew. See, here's what I didn't factor for, and neither did the church. It took more than me just believing to be able to walk out that principle of deliverance. See, listen, salvation is free, but the deliverance is going to cost you. Salvation, absolutely, 100% free. Gift, you can't work for it, you can't earn it, it ain't got nothing to do with you. You just got in the right line that day, and you got hooked up. Whoa, I got blood. Actually, cost salvation. No worries. Here's what's going to cost you your life is to walk that out. And so the truth of the matter is, guys, no one helped me major on walking it out. That in of itself is a skill set. And so in our Marriages and Parenting Successfully community, we have an online relationship academy. Well, we have people from all over the country that come in a room. We have a marriage, a couples room that meets on Tuesday nights. We have a parenting room that meets on Tuesday nights. Later on that night, after you done put the kids to bed, we let the parents come in. They love it. Them jokers is down. Let's go. Let's get it. We start that one at 8:30. We ready to go. And then we have a women's one that meets first and third Thursdays. And then we do a men's one on Sundays. And those are more spiritual development type things. But the whole goal of it is to create a group environment, listen to me very carefully, with people who are on the same mission at the same time to accomplish the same goal. So as you're being encouraged, this isn't all willy-nilly. This is specifically in the area of your marriage and in your parenting skills. See, because you can, most of y'all don't know how to communicate. Or you know how to talk. Trust me, you got that part down. I talk to brothers all the time. But I told her that. No, you didn't. How do you know I ain't talking to her? Because she's not doing it. Here's how I know you communicated effectively. When you speak, people listen, and they hear you. And they do something else. It's called they actually receive it. How many of y'all know there's a major difference between hearing somebody and receiving it? How does it look when somebody receives something you said? Somebody talk to me. How does it look? What are some things you see when you know, oh, they received that? Somebody tell me. Talk to me. First thing come to your mind. They respond what, Drew? In action. When someone receives what you say, their behavior changes. Husbands, listen to me. If your wife's behavior is not changing, she don't receive you. She's not receiving you. Can I go a little deeper? If she doesn't receive the sperm, there is no baby born. It don't matter that you gave it. Hello? Oh, you can release the sperm. Don't mean she receives it. I know I don't need to go any further. Y'all already there. I paused on purpose. I need y'all to hear that because we're majoring on the fact that, well, I said that already. I'm telling you right now, you didn't. If you did, you said it in the wrong language. She didn't understand your language. Or you said it to the wrong person. You said it at the wrong time. You said it with the wrong tone. Somehow you have not communicated effectively. I do a whole section on just how to communicate effectively. We call it communication made simple. There are components of communicating. And when you know it and you know it well, you can get to the place where we are. And by her standards, we've only had 5 major arguments in 19 years. 5. I'm not interested in number 6 because they were doozies. I remember every one of them. We're not going to talk about that. It might bring a little something up. But here's what I will tell you. Here's what I didn't say. I didn't say we don't disagree. Oh, we disagree every day, all day, several times a day. But Keith, I promise you, my skill set is so honed in communication, even in a disagreement, we good. We can have a disagreement and still go have dinner. We can have a disagreement that is nothing personal. And when it is personal, she gets to check me and say, wait a minute, well, what's going on? Talk to me. Why is that? What are you telling yourself? Because we understand where that comes from. When you take stuff personal, it's because you attach, listen to me, a story to the narrative. You did that. I didn't do that. You told yourself what that means. And as a result, you took it personal. That's how we can fall out with our children, particularly I'm talking about co-parents. Let me explain something to you. When you get to the place as a co-parent that you can literally, I don't know if you ever heard, there's a book called The Four Agreements. It'll bless your life. It'll bless your life. One of them is don't take nothing personal. These are four agreements that people make with themselves. Don't take anything personal. Because when you get offended, newsflash, you choose that. An offense is never something put on you. An offense is always something that's taken. I took offense. Well, why'd you take that then? That's a real question. I'm not even being rhetorical. So I have to learn myself. So we talk to each other like that. Well, I'm offended. Well, why are you offended? And that, those are not fighting words in my house. So for some of y'all, I'd cost you not to say that right now. You need to be coached up first before you just talk like that. I'm going to get some of y'all in divorce court real fast. Worse yet, some of y'all going to jail tonight because somebody going to get cut because that's the rule. I get it. But when you're in the right environment and you learn these tools and these skill sets, and now you get to practice them in public with people, and you get to be called on it, and you get to listen to a brother say, bro, I understand why she cussed you out. Here's how you did that wrong. Kim, let me ask you a question. If I said it this way, and then she and I do a role play right in the group in front of you, not to shame you, but to show you what it looks like, because my wife is right there. Or my wife and I will role play that right back and say, Sheree, okay, let's take Keith and Kim's situation. Let's role play. How could that have looked differently? Let's role play four. Let's come up with three scenarios that we could have done differently than them. And now while they're watching, we're actually showing them. Guys, that's how we've made it. We had communities of people like that in our lives that would literally show, Glenn, this is how you messed that up. And this is why she ain't talking to you. There's no such thing as you ain't talking to nobody in my house. Are you serious right now? You're not what? Talking to me. And it's funny because we have this little joke, and she'll say, I'm not talking to you right now. I say, I know that's right. We're gone not talking to you. That's why I'm not leaving. You will talk to me eventually. You get what I'm saying? So we mess with each other, that sort of thing. Because guys, it literally can get to the place of where you know these tools and these skill sets so well, you become so self-aware that you can call yourself out. Let me help you understand what self-awareness is. Self-awareness is your ability to accurately perceive your own emotions in the moment and understand your tendencies across situations. Self-awareness literally says, I know where I am emotionally, and I know how that affects the room. And because of how it's affecting the room, I am going to now pull that in and do something constructive with it as opposed to destructive with it, because I have more concern with the room than I do with me. The room can be your wife. The room can be your husband. The room can be your children. Because fathers, listen to me very carefully. Children do what you do, not what you say. And so because of that, I don't care what you say. They're going to do what you do. So if you want to teach your son at 5 how to love women, love his mother in front of him. Apologize to his mother in front of him. Oh, I know I'm on some toes. See, but the human part of us don't want us to do that. And so what I'm telling you, you're a part of the problem and not the solution. And so that's why your child is now tripping. And now you ask the question, well, what got into them? You did. Are you kidding me right now? They watched you. And here's what I know. You should get an A as a parent. You should get an A. You should get an A for failing. Y'all ain't hearing me. My parents will tell you, they're both 71 years old. They'll be 72 in January and March of next year. They will tell you that we failed. And we did it sincerely. Because we thought we was right. Here's where we get to let them off the hook. The truth of the matter is they did the best they knew with what they was working with. Here's what I'm going to submit to you. A therapist told me this a long time ago. He said, Glenn, I don't know if I believe in failures. I believe people do the best that they know with what it is that they work with. And unfortunately, because the standard of what they know is not up to where it needs to be, the truth of the matter is that they should get an A down here with what it is that they know. So if you're in a trig class and you fail geometry, you're going to fail trig. I'm so sorry. If you're in geometry and you failed algebra one, you're going to fail geometry. I promise you. You may eke by because they're a little bit different, but here's what I also know. You'll fail physics for sure. And you're talking to a guy who's getting high in ninth grade in algebra class. And because I knew I was going to fail, I opt out of that, and I didn't take that one where they had to say, you know, you got the choice of ramping up and take the next level jump. I didn't take the next level because me and Weed was cool. So I'm not doing that. It's going to cause me to think too hard, mess around and blow my high. Are you kidding me? Why would we do that? Why would we do that? Why would we do that? And so I'm in the 11th grade, and that's the first time I found out what the word prerequisite meant. How many of y'all know that this dude found that out while trying to get into college? I realized, bro, that ain't happening for you. Well, I was in junior ROTC, had been company commander in junior ROTC. I knew how to lead. I knew how to influence people. I didn't have much happening up here. I had a lot of EQ, but I didn't have much IQ, I promise you. I'll break that down later. The truth of the matter is, guys, is that I never will forget the Citadel. They came to our class, and they did this whole presentation. I said, I'd like to go there. That sounds like where I need to be. Standing tall, looking good. Oh, I could just do the whole thing. I love anything that caused me to be on stage. I could do that part. It is a problem. When the guy told me, he said, oh, yeah, all the entry-level students that come to the Citadel have already taken, many of them, AP calculus. I said, huh? Yeah, that's a prerequisite. What'd that mean? Yeah, sometimes I have to slow your pastor down because he knows $200 words. And I stopped at the $25 joints. $25, that's all I got. That's all I got. That's all I got. $25, that's all I got. See, some of y'all are asking for, listen to me, $200 from your spouse and all they working with is $25. That's all he got. But because your expectation is a $200 man, all he got is $25. That's all you're going to get. And until he learns and earns more, you'll never get more. But if somehow you can be okay with $25, you'll have the best man on the planet. He got that. Y'all hear how I just changed your perspective just that fast? That's all he working with. Some of y'all, you got a 50-cent man. He ain't got a dollar. You need that dollar, though. Yo, I need all four of them quarters. Come on, bro. Where you at? Where you at? I'm going to need that. He ain't got that. All he got is 50 cents. But instead of you being excited about 50 cents, two coins, two case quarters, you get upset and bothered because he ain't bringing the other 50 cents to the table. And the question is, can you live on 50 cents? Probably. Challenge is that you don't want to, and you're afraid to say that. This church has taught you that you hang in there forever, whatever, and whenever, while your kids watch that on your watch. And now we wonder why we're birthing children who can't keep it together. They don't see it modeled. Why would they keep it together? I told you should get an A for failing. I got mine. I told you I only owed them $25. I got straight A's. Straight A's. Felt good about my straight A's, too. Y'all, don't be sad. Can we go on to point number two? Point number two, number three, three steps of becoming whole. Number one is self-awareness. Number two is own your own stuff. Second step to becoming whole. You've got to learn how to own your own stuff. And I'm being very nice because we're in church. Does that make sense? Let me tell you what that means. I'm doing a workshop next in July over in Suffolk, and if you guys follow me on Facebook, I'll be putting it out there. I'll be glad to tag you on it, and you certainly are welcome to come. But it's called Fixing Broken Fences. It's the name of that's the name of the course. It's a 2-hour workshop that I'm gonna do. We're gonna film it, we're gonna produce it, and we're gonna make it really nice so we can put it out. But fixing broken fences have everything to do with establishing, listen to me, healthy boundaries. Here's a problem, guys. We don't know what they look like. See, because by definition, a boundary is a property line. You can see it when you go home. It's called your fence. You know where your property ends and your neighbors begin. Consequently, you're not going to mow his lawn. You're not going to water his backyard because that's his what? Stuff. The challenge is that in relationships, those property lines are invisible. And you can't see them. So here's what you're now charged with in relationships. Listen to me carefully, guys. We're almost there. And that is, you now have to figure out how to own your own emotions, your own behaviors, and your own attitude. See, it is not my, and I'm, newsflash, here we go. I'm going to mess you up again. It is not my job to make my wife happy. That's a farce, and it doesn't work. Let me help you understand it. It's her job to make her happy. I hear it all the time. Well, you complete me. Let me help you out. That sounds really, really esoterical, and I got that's my $25 word. That's as far as I go. Pat. Real ooey gooey and all that stuff. But here's what I know: the fallacy in that. Listen, that was actually a $15 word fallacy. I like that. Y'all like that? Y'all like that? The fallacy in that is that the truth of the matter is God never designed you to complete one another. That's his job. So you walking around figuring out, well, why don't she, you know, I should be able to say one thing, she should fend for my sins. Why are y'all robots? What is this? So we going to King's Dominion now? I mean, what is this? Wearing matching t-shirts? I mean, what is this? You frick, she's frack, you peep, she's repeat. What is this? Really? Is that what this is going to be built on? And so 18 years in, when that gets old, after 18 months, you're trying to figure out how did you last 18 years? I don't like you. Because you're trying to fight a battle that's not winnable. I want you guys to learn how to pick your battles. And you're going to have to learn how to fight things that are winnable. One of the things that I help coach people is identifying the battles worth fighting. And the ones that are not worth fighting, leave them alone. Because there are some battles, even when you win them, you lose them. Because of the price that's paid to wage the war, listen to me very carefully, it's not worth the outcome of winning. It's called investing in something that just busts. It doesn't produce the return on investment that you need in order to be able to produce a profit. Listen to me very carefully. And so that's why your relationships are bankrupt, because you have no profit. You have no margin. You have none of that. You can't enjoy it. And so now you are working to just work. And just like that, that's a miserable life on your job, that's a miserable life in your house. I ain't working just to work. Let me explain something to you. I'm not responsible for Cherie's attitude. She have a tough day, and she comes home, and she's a little worked up, and she says, and her face says, and she ain't got to say it, her face says, oh, don't talk to me, because it's been one of them kind of days. And I look at her and say, hey, how you doing? And she says, I'm doing all right. I said, well, how was your day? It wasn't all that great. I said, okay, great. Is there anything I can do to help? Because listen to me. Listen to me, guys. I am responsible to you, but not for you. That's called you having to own your stuff. I'm responsible to you, so I'll be nice. I'll even offer to do something if it helps you. I didn't say if it makes you feel better. Those are two different things. Sometimes you need a little help. It ain't got nothing to do with how you feel. You just need somebody to, look, can you just grab the groceries for me? That's all I need. But this attitude I'm bringing in this house, that's my problem. As soon as I put them groceries down, I'm going back to my office. I'll see you later when I get there. See you later. See you later, boo. And I'll just roll out. I'll say, hey, well, here's the deal. Since there's nothing I can do to help you, I just want to let you know I'll be in my office, so when you need me, you know where to find me. I'll be out back. I'm going to run to the gym real quick. I'll be 45 minutes. I'll be back. If you need me, text me. When I come back, that attitude is right. You know why? Because I did not rescue her, listen to me, from the natural order of consequences. She went through something. She's reaping the consequences of what that is. My job, Aaron, is not to rescue her and now get in the middle of that. You need to feel all that and go ahead through your process and let me go do what I got to do. And once you figure that out, we can do business. Does that make sense? And so now I'm not coming home, Kim, and now she jumping through hoops trying to figure out, well, how do I get him straight? How, boo, is there anything I can do for you? Well, can I cook you your special dinner, Negro? I'm not jumping through them hoops because now, listen to me, how many of y'all know, if you do somebody's job long enough, whose job does it become? If you do somebody else's job long enough, whose job does it become? It's an unwritten rule. It's understood. So now, all the time, my job is to make you what? And so when I don't do that, now I'm not doing my what? And if I'm not doing my job, I get what? It's called divorce. It's called now I'm stepping out because somebody else is more interesting because they will now make me what? It's a system, guys. It's a system. Now, the good news is that once you figure this out, it totally works for you. Number three, is that I want you to learn how to embrace your differences. These are all three steps to getting hold. Now, I'm going to teach you. You'll get a good pushing around a little bit, but I'm not going to preach you to death. That's Dr. Drew's job, and God knows she's good at it, but I wish. Let me explain something to you. This ain't got nothing to do with the notes. So when I hear good preaching like that, it makes me sad that I can't preach. It really just does. And can I give y'all a news flash? Most people don't preach with substance. Most people, they just hoop and just be hooping and hollering and all. And when you get preached and you got substance in there, now you're about to throw stuff. Well, that kind of stuff makes me mad. Because I'm saying, God, why ain't you make me like that? I got to really work on my being and owning my stuff, right? Because that ain't my job. Why can't you just sit here and enjoy the ride, brother? So I do. So I'm not going to do that. But what I will do is I will challenge you. And here's what I will tell you is that when you leave out of here, you will never look at relationships the same again, ever. Three steps to wholeness. Number one is what, guys? What did we say? Number two is what? Number three is what? Guys, let me help you understand something. Your strength, say strength, lies in your differences. Give you a quick contrast. I was married 12 years before I told y'all that. My former wife, I don't like to call her an ex because ex denotes something. So I think words are extremely powerful. I don't use ex. I don't use step. I don't use anything other than something I want. So if I don't want a relationship where I'm walking on you, I'm not going to refer to you as a step because that's exactly what that refers to. Now, I understand why our culture uses it. It's because we want to create a demarcation. Well, let's come up with a new word. How about bonus? This is my bonus mom. She's my instead of ex, she's my extra. I got hooked up. I got two for the price of what? One. So y'all see what the language does? I promise you, tomorrow you'll understand why our blended family works the way it does. Jada Pinkett Smith and Will Smith aren't only ones that are crushing it in the blended family game. We just ain't famous yet. Oh, I can tell you some stories that will help you understand that, brother, let me explain something to you. You don't need a court system to help you argue your case. You don't need a what they call the people, the mediator. Thank you. Only mediator you need is Jesus and your own self-control. But because we won't be disciplined, we need someone else to do it for us. And that's why the courts are gladly able to step in. No worries, we will do it for you where we don't care about your kid. All we care is about that money you getting ready to pay us. And the truth of the matter is y'all stupid because you could have paid each other that money and you still win. I figured that out, and I wrote a book about it. It's called How I Got My Son Back. I'm telling you right now, I lay that out, how I got to the place where I'm paying my wife $983.22 every month. I'm paying my extra parent, my bonus parent, my co-parent, not my ex-wife, and I'm glad to pay it. And the courts didn't make me, but I did use their system of math to figure out what I should pay. Because here's what I knew. There's going to come a day that I'm going to have to get a return on that investment. Oh, I knew that was the day was coming because here was a secret aspiration, and it wasn't too secret because I used to tell them I wanted the opportunity to parent my son full time, and I had to pay for that. See, some of y'all aren't willing to pay the price, and that's why you don't get the return on that investment that you're looking for because you're not willing to put up. So therefore, you have to shut up and take whatever comes to you. Does that make sense? And the truth of the matter is, I ain't got time. Listen, guys, it got to the place where she started paying me child support because I'm raising him full time. She didn't have $983.22, but it's cool. I took every bit of it and was glad that I had to do it. And it was out of her mouth that she said, you know what, because I do understand you're going to ready to leave this six-figure job and take a 70% pay cut to answer the call of God that's on your life to go into ministry full time. I get that. And I've watched you long enough to know that this ain't no game. And so my question is, let's just figure out what we need to do. Because see, guys, you have to understand, my $983.22 help her to get not her first but her second rental property home while your man was renting. And so with humility I paid that number, and the courts never said I had to. People used to say, oh, when they found out what that number was, boy, you stupid, are you serious? Now I wouldn't have said, see, what you don't know is that you're not looking at the return on the investment that I'm going to get. So I spent a number of years just doing my job and doing my due diligence. And then so when the opportunity came, she called me and said, it's your turn. I said, well, thank you. I'm glad it came at 12. I wish it came at 5 or 8, but I'll do what I got to do, and we won't be petty. We will not traffic in the petty. Yes, ma'am, I will take him. At the lowest point financially in my life, I didn't have the money, I didn't have the resources, but what I had, listen to me, mother, I had community. And that's why my son at 24 years old can say, Dad, I want a relationship like y'all got. Not his mom and his bonus dad, but like us. Because he watched me, listen to me, catch his parents, he watched me change on his watch. One of the most powerful tools you can give your children is change. When you evolve on their watch, I promise you, there is an equity that you put in them that you can call on anytime you need to. So that's why my children, while I am alive, are calling me blessed. That's why they can call me up on a regular basis now that they got children, at least the older one does, and she can say, Dad, I get it. Thank you. I said, really? She said, I never thought that you knew what you was doing. I just appreciate it now. Why am I saying all this, guys? Because if you don't do these three things, you will never become whole. And thus, your relationship is doomed before it starts. And I don't care how many times you press reset. Ask Cherie, I'm her third husband. They do say three times the charm, though. I'm still trying to figure that one out. It's a rebut. But I'm her third. Now, you have to understand, her daughter has had two fathers before me, but she calls me dad. Why is that? Is it because I'm special? Is it because I'm God's child? Is it because I prayed really, really good and careful? Is it because I know scriptures up and down? Is it because I walk and talk with Jesus and I say God like that? No, it's because I work. Yeah. That's why I keep telling you that your relationships, if you do not put work, we have a t-shirt, my wife's wearing it tonight. It says marriage is hard work. However, say however. The ROI for my business, non-business people, means return on investment, is priceless. See, the return on the investment is that now my bonus parent and my son's mother can call me and say, listen, Darren and I are going on vacation for 10 days, and I haven't told you all the reasons, but my son is in a wheelchair now. He had a debilitating disease that hit him 3 years ago, and he's battling back to try and get some things in order. Nothing that he did, just kind of showed up. But as a result, he's confined to a wheelchair and he needs some assistance. And he's a grown man. He's 25 years old. And so now he's had to go through the whole piece, and his mother's having to wipe his butt again and all this kind of stuff. And he's getting it together. He's pretty independent, about 80% back. So he would never allow you to feel sorry for him. Trust me, his work ethic is sick. His faith is contagious. And he has a resolve to just not quit. So trust me, don't cry him no rivers. But the truth of the matter is that his mother can call me and say, Darren and I are going on vacation. We're going to the West Coast to see Darren's daughter. She's getting married. Can you come and stay at the house with Justin for 10 days? You have to understand, this is a woman I committed adultery on 12 separate times. Not because I'm proud of that, but because it's true. You have to understand, there's a woman that I humiliated because I was a youth pastor during those days. I had to stand up in front of a whole church and confess what I'd done. My grandmother sitting on that front row, and her her sitting on this one, and my mother sitting right there. So my life is characterized by making the adjustment and changing on people's watch, and that's why I get the return on that investment. Oh, brother, let me explain something to you. John Maxwell had it exactly right when he said leadership is influence, nothing more, nothing less. You don't have to be in their lives to influence their lives. I call it fathering from afar, and it's possible. Because you can be in their lives and not be physically there because of your influence. And trust me, they will not miss a beat. I promise you. You ask my children. So why am I saying this, guys? I need y'all to understand that your relationships are coming unglued because of you. Not because you don't love, but because you won't work. Last thing I want to say to this, there are four quick things I want you to understand about embracing your difference. And then we got to go. Oh, yeah, we got to go because that restaurant's getting ready to close. So here we go. Here we go. I want you guys to understand, when I talk about embracing your differences, I'm going to rattle this off. We'll probably go into a little bit more deeper. Is that there are four basic strengths that everybody has. Four basic strengths that everybody has. I am a firm believer that in order for you to win, you need to double down on your strengths and leave your weaknesses alone. The reason why is because there's a reason they call them weaknesses. You're not good at them. Leave it alone. Because if you get so strong in your strength, what happens is that, listen to me very quick, very carefully, anytime you grow personally, it becomes attractive to other people. People want to play with winners. That's why LeBron can get anyone to come play with him versus the other way around, right? Everybody's watching, what is he going to do? Kawhi Leonard just got finished the whole situation, like, because he blossomed on the, and people are like really, really trying to figure out, how can we play with this guy? People want to play with winners, but when you're losing, people don't want to play with you. And so I'm going to encourage you to embrace your strengths. In order to embrace it, you have to know what they are. Now, many of you are in relationships and you're not aware of your strengths, and you have the strength, and these are the four basic areas of your strengths, and I want you to notice, and I'm going to give you some scripture for all my scholars, and you don't think I just did all this, and we didn't talk about Jesus at all, and I'm going to show you how all this relates to scripture. But number one is the executor. This is the kind of relationship or the kind of strength that relationships have. There's someone in the relationship that flows in the strength of the executor. The executor is the person who knows how to make things happen. They can make it happen, I promise you, if you give them a half a minute. I love how Kevin Durant plays the game because he can make a shot happen. It just, you figure out how to, he didn't need no space, no separation. He just pulled up and boom, you just got scored on. He makes it happen. He's an executor. In your relationship, husband, wife, wife, husband, sometimes it's somebody else in your family, you will find that there's an executor in that relationship, and if you allow them room to play to their strength, it will benefit you. Number two, there's the influencer. We talked a little bit before about how influence, leadership is influence, nothing more and nothing less. There are people, that is their strength zone. They are influencers by nature. That is one of my strengths. If you're not careful, on the flip side or the dark side of the influencer are manipulators. These are your used car salesmen that can sell water to a whale. These people literally, that's because they're influencers and it's gone wrong, Aaron. But when that strength is honed and it's doubled down on and they know how to do it with integrity, I promise you it will benefit your relationship. The other one is a relationship builder. That's another kind of strength. By nature, you are a relationship builder. When you have a relationship builder in your house, listen, fellas, if your wife is a relationship builder, I'm going to caution you to allow her to do that and not think that she's just about being a little too forward with people and just being extra. She's a relationship builder. More than likely, that is her strength. And when you play to that, here's what I promise you. Relationship builders find favor quicker than anybody. And the reason why is people actually like them. I don't know why. That's one of my strengths. People find themselves doing stuff for me, and they don't know why. Well, I love that about building a team, because that means I get to get stuff done. And you don't have to know why. You'll learn later. We'll figure that out. But the point I'm making is, if I'm allowed room to work, Cherie understands that. That's why she's not tripping about the different things and the people I'm coaching and all that kind of stuff, because now my integrity is right. She doesn't have an issue there. And I know how to put the right kind of people around me so that I safeguard people and put cameras in my blind spots. And so now I get to do what it is that I do. And I'm a relationship builder by nature. And so when I'm allowed to grow in that strength and double down on that strength, what happens is my relationship prospers. There are things that we get privileged to do and to say and to go, and things that we're getting because of my relationships. I am here because of my relationship with your pastor, not because he can afford me, because he can. Neither can you. And the reason why is because my time is worth more than your money. Does that make sense? And so when I have people that say, coach, oh my God, I'm not your coach. It's okay. But here's what I know. I don't have to adjust that, because here's what I also know. You're going to get way more value than whatever I charge. It's going to change your life. We can't put a price tag on that. Why do I say that? Because it's relationship that got me in front of you. That's my strength. And if that's your strength and you play to it, I promise you, your relationship will go to another level. Now, this is my wife's strength. This next one, last one. Oh, my God, and I love it. I used to hate it, but I love it because I've learned to embrace the differences. But the other one is y'all ready for this one? It's hard to say it sometimes because, you know, I have to tell myself I like this one, but I don't like it that much because it rubs me the wrong way. But this person is strong when it comes to being a strategic thinker. That is a strength. Let me help you out. Strategic people are not fun sometimes, most the time, unless they learn, because they are in relationship with a relationship builder, to let that relationship builder be him and strengthen them in that area. And so now my wife can be found on Facebook being just as silly as she wants to be, and I know that is not her DNA. There's a movie that we love to watch. We used to watch it years ago on our anniversary for probably the first 5 years we've been married, called The Story of Us with Michelle Pfeiffer and Bruce Willis. I don't know if you've ever seen it. And there's this one part where she is saying, he's like, whatever happened to the fun person? And they're getting ready to get a divorce, and it's really bad. And she was like, the fun person is here. People, people, people. And she's trying to get the fun person out because you beat it out of me. I used to be a fun person. And the truth of the matter is that they did not know how to function in their strength. And guys, when you flow like that, it makes people envious. And this is what I'm going to close with. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 19 through 21, and I love the way the Amplified puts this. It says, if they were a single organ, it's talking about the body. And I want you to get a picture of the church. If they were all a single organ, where would the rest of the body be? Verse 20, but now as things really are, there are many parts, different limbs and organs, but a single body. The eye does not get to say to the hand that I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. The premise of this scripture is that the body goes everywhere together. Either we're winning or we're losing together. So if my wife is losing, I'm losing. It is important for me to position her to win. If I am losing, my wife is losing. It is important for her to position me to win. If I'm winning, she's going to win by default. My wife was a severe non-communicator when we first met. As you could tell, I had that part down okay. I used to wear her out because I always wanted to talk about it. She'd look at me, there's nothing to talk about. What are you talking about? Why would we want to talk about that? Who does that? And I recognized that that was my strength and it wasn't hers. And so the more I talked, the more it frustrated her. And so I had to figure that one out, because here's what I knew. I knew what 12 years in a not in a row, 9 years and then 3 years of separation. It was painful. I didn't want that again. And so I had to figure that out. And so I had to learn to acquiesce. That's another $25 word. I'm doing good. I had four $25 words tonight. I had to learn to acquiesce and back up. And that's why I tell men all the time, listen, let me help you understand. God gave you the unique ability to lead your wife anywhere if you're in position. Problem is, if you can't lead your wife, you're out of position. I promise you that. One of the things I try to teach men all the time, and it's hard, that's why I love getting them in a room by themselves, Bishop. I can talk man talk, and Aaron, we can just go in, and I can tell you, you are tripping. I told him a man one time, it was in front of his wife, but I had to do it because it had to come out, Keith. It just had to. And he was just cutting up, and I told him, we was on a Zoom call, because that's how we do our coaching stuff, and I don't care where you live, saying, yo, you need your cell phone. We talked to him, and I looked at him. I said, Steve. He was going in. Da-da-da-da-da. I said, Steve. Da-da-da-da. He just going. Steve! He jumped just like Mother Johnson. I apologize, Mother. He jumped just like that. He said, what? I said, now I understand why she don't want to talk to you. You don't know how to listen, sir. And if you do her like that in front of me, she's in trouble when I'm not in the room. That's a problem. And here's what I'm going to tell you. It's going to end in divorce if you don't play your cards right, brother, because I would leave you. My boundaries say you don't get to talk to me like that. You need to watch your language, bro. You need to talk to me. Get your tone straight. When I first married this one, she said, listen, I don't respond to tones that you use. They shut me down. I don't know why. I don't know what they're attached to yet. She went through therapy. She figured all that out. She learned to own that kind of stuff. But in the meantime, your man started dialing back his tone. And so I might be on 10 with the men, but I'm on 2 with her. Tone ain't volume. Oh, I ain't got time to help. Tone is not volume. Tone is intent. Tone is the angle you use. Tone is your heart. Tone is motive. That's what tone is. And brother, you get your tone right, I promise you, she'll do anything you want her to do anytime. As a matter of fact, she'll do it so much that she'll have you running around talking about, can you please stop? Can you please stop? Like, you're doing too much. You're doing too much, baby. I have to tell my wife, that ain't funny no more. Like, why are you still being funny? Just being funny. It's not funny no more. The joke has been over. I told y'all, funny ain't in her DNA, but she's learned to be funny because she's safe. Because now she's not around a person who's just going to judge that and not let her function in her strength. I love being there. I love it. You know why I love it? Because it's a picture of what God wants. Here's what I'm going to promise you. You can lead the people to Christ if your marriage is right. They will so envy what it is that you do that they have to figure out who you are and how do you do that. And there are people who follow God because of the example that I lead. And I don't know them, but I promise you they do. And so I want to help you guys understand this works with your children. We're done. This works for your spouse. This works for your significant other. And tonight, I just felt like I just wanted to have a conversation. A lot of the stuff that was on my paper, we're going to probably fill it out the rest of this weekend. I'll talk to you about some of these principles, guys. Please come tomorrow. I'm going to be up late, fellowship a little bit. We're going to be up early. Breakfast with the Brookses at 8 o'clock. If y'all not following me on Facebook at Glenn P. Brooks Jr., LLC, you need to. We're going to be on. Your pastor, Dr. Juju, is going to be on with us, and we're going to have a good time cutting up. My wife is going to be there. We're going to have a good time reaching people for the kingdom. Let me tell you what God wants. God wants you whole because he wants people in the kingdom. And the reason why people are not coming in the kingdom is because they're following after broken people. What do you really have to offer? My life is better than yours, and I don't know Jesus. Why would I follow you? I didn't say I'm richer than you. I'm saying I'm more wealthy. My life looks better than yours. I don't know Jesus. So why would I follow you in this so-called Jesus that you have? For what? But when my life is at least as good as yours, if not better, that makes you raise an eyebrow. What in the world have you got to have? I got a love that won't quit. Here's where your love will go awry. It's not enough to work through the problems and cause you to be whole if it's not God's love. Amen? Y'all get something tonight? Was I able to help you? Let's get a Lord of praise.
How many of y'all like me just feel like you just want to exhale?